Ooh, this is going to look absolutely charming on camera. Look at that. Lots and lots of little cuts all over my hand. What could possibly have caused this? Behold, the hand of a man who lives with an 11-week-old cat. Where are you, freak cat? Go and say hello to everyone. Let's do something no one's ever done before and put a cat on the internet. There you go, you little freak. Come on, tell everybody how many toes you've got. 22. 6 on the front, 6 on that front, 5 and 5. What are you? A nuisance. Yes, you is. You is a nuisance. The lovely nuisance. All right, where are you going? Welcome back, everyone. But I have to say, stop what you're doing. We've got a bit of an emergency situation on our hands. Yesterday, my son went off and was very proud of himself because he went off shopping with his mum, and with his own pocket money, he bought himself a toy gun. And here is the packaging of said toy gun. It is a City Police Close Quarter Battle Force tactical playset. It comes with a gun, a badge, and some little pellets. So, unfortunately, within 5 minutes of getting this thing home, it was broken. Already the grip was broken. I sort of fixed that, but he went off and had a play with it for a few minutes and came back and said, "Oh, Dad, this thing's falling to pieces." First casualty, it's the crappy little shield, and yep, the back clip is broken completely off, and we don't know where that's gone. Here are the little pellets that he was firing, and he was in the middle of playing with that, and suddenly the trigger stopped working. It's just going click, 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 and then stopped. So we did a bit of rummaging around, and here's some of the parts we found around the house. This thing literally crumbled and broke apart. The plastic is extraordinarily brittle. It's just because it's a cheap piece. I mean, as I said in a few videos ago, about 10 years ago, the price of oil went up, so manufacturers around the world started putting less of the oil into their plastic, and that just makes it brittle and it doesn't last long. It crumbles after only a couple of years. So anyway, here is the gun in question. Now, as I said right out of the bat, the handle was broken, and I did do a minor repair on that. You can possibly just see that there. I glued that back together. And he went off and played, and as I said, the first thing to go was the trigger. Now, the reason why the trigger broke is because something inside snapped out and started rattling around. Also, you'll see this little hole here. Now, on the inside, there is a track, and the trigger slides in and out of that. But with this hole being there, it just rattled around. Let's get those parts again. So it could no longer track back and forth. So the idea now is to try and do something with this. It will never fire again. It's just not worth me building too much with it because it's just a cheap tatty toy from the local tat shop. But what we will do, we use this as an opportunity to make it look a bit nicer because that's what he wants to do. But I tell you something, this looks strangely familiar. I just feel as if I've seen it somewhere before. But where?
Quietly, or there will be trouble.
I don't know. It'll come to me, I guess. Right, let's go off and get some bits and make this thing look pretty. So as you can plainly see, I've got loads of stuff on the desk now. I've got some spare plastic, in fact it's the scrap that I want. Got my glues and my knives and other bits and pieces, but most significantly, I've split the gun into its left and right halves. Now, for the most part, I am going to work on it in this fashion. It's only when I come to do the weathering that I'll put it back together again. For now, everything is going to be in two parts. The first part of the repair will be using this little bit of scrap. And it's only that little bit that I need. And it is going to sit in here and repair that little chip out of the trigger guard. Also, there is a chip just in here that's come out, just purely because of the rubbish plastic, and I'm going to put in another piece there just to replace it. So the first thing I need to do is trim this to size. Luckily it's the right width, just need to cut a bit of length down, and I am going to leave it slightly overlong to about here, because I want this to act as a bit of a spring, so that when this trigger guard comes back, it's got something to be sprung back with, in addition to that little spring there. So the first thing I need to do is nip this down to size, and I think, about that sort of length would do. So let's do that now. Snip! Now it's time to glue it. A little bit more in and around there, and just push it gently into position and hold that until it sets. Well, this has been sat for a while. I've done a little bit of work on this side. As you can see, I've put in the little brace piece, which also acts as a spring up here for the trigger. I do need to put in a bit of filler into here just to smooth that off and level it. You'll also notice I've added in a piece here. Now, there is a small hole in the bottom of the barrel when you put it together, so that's just to close it off. I'm not going to put any filler in that, we can just pretend that's a piece of detailing. Also, you'll notice there is a tiny little piece of plastic that I've just wedged in there. It's literally just glued on, it's just a little edge that I've put on slightly oversized and then took, you know, a nail file and just went zip, 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 zip. It's not a perfect fit and it doesn't have to be. You know, it's close enough for this particular project, because this thing is going to just sit on a shelf and look vaguely pretty. My son has decided he doesn't want to risk ruining it anymore. So what I have to do now, if I remember rightly, is... what do I have to do now? Oh yeah, I've already talked about it. Add in that filler. So I'm going to go off and do that. You don't need to see that, I don't think. Oh, but we'll see. Probably when I've already done it and I'm starting to sand it down and smooth it. So there's the trigger guard, all repaired and filed and smoothed and sanded and what have you. So it's as good as new. And while I was there, waiting for all this to cure and whatnot, and seeing as I had sanding blocks out, I thought I'd try and get rid of most of the egregious seams. So that one's gone, the ones along here have disappeared, as of the back, and I did a bit along the top. I mean, I don't have to be perfect with this, because it's only going to be seen from a distance, but just, as I said, get rid of the egregious ones. So I've only placed it together just so I could get those seams nice and tight. Now I need to split it apart again and on to the main course of this build, which is the painting or the finishing. So that is what I'm going to do next. Let's see what I get up to. So before we can get into the meat of everything, which is the painting, the first thing I'd like to do is prep the surface of this little plastic gun here. And to do that, I'm going to be using this. It's a Scotch-Brite scouring pad for all intents and purposes. And what I need to do is literally just rub it over this and create a very small key. It's like roughing up the surface, and that gives the paint something to grab and bite to. So all I've got to do, what we're not trying to do here is sand the thing down. We just want to very slightly rough up the surface. Now I've got to go very carefully around this bit here because it is just stuck on. There's nothing really holding it other than the glue. So I'll just go around it. That just about does it. So, if I angle this piece in the slightly dingy light in here, you can probably just see there are scuffs all over it. Now, as I said before, I'm not trying to introduce new scratches. These are very, very minor tiny little microscopic indentations, if you want to call it that. And that is the key. So now all I need to do is just give this a little bit of a wipe down with a damp rag just to get rid of any dust. And it's time for spray painting. And of course, the first spray paint that goes down on here is the grey primer. So, woo! So this is the primer I'm going to be using. It's just a standard grey primer that I bought from a pound shop. So I'm not going to use the good stuff on this. It's not worth it. So, let's get on with it. Oh, great. Great. That's what you get for buying cheap paints. Okay, let's try another one. That can go straight in the bin. Bugger. Now we've got another one. That's silver. I need a grey. What's this? That's silver too. Silver. Do I have anything that's not silver? Ah. Ah, that's better. Right, take two. Oops. So now that the primer has dried, I just want to take a simple kitchen towel and just gently rub over the surface. All this is doing is just very slightly smoothing it out, just to take any little imperfections. I mean, there are several little moulding imperfections in this, but I'm not really overly bothered by that. Just want to get a sort of polished look before I put the black paint down, because that's the next stage in the proceedings. So. There we are, just a bit of a polish. Don't want to introduce any fingerprints or grease onto this, so that's why I've got this glove on. That's starting to look nice. Standard matte black spray paint. I want to do a tack coat first and then go a little bit heavy. Really, I should have brought this in last night from the conservatory and kept it in the house so it stayed nice and warm. At the moment, it's a bit cold because we are heading into autumn and therefore winter. I could put it into a bucket of hot water, but really, I can't be bothered. So let's see if I'm going to rue that decision and see how we get along. Test spray, yeah, that looks good. If it goes on cold, it has the tendency to orange peel and crinkle up, which will ruin the finish. But actually, it's looking all right. So let's just keep going. Still a tack coat. Well, it's been about an hour since I sprayed this, and I think we're at a stage now where we can call that done and move on to the next process. But before we do, just like before, I have rubbed this surface down just to give a little bit of a key and to smooth things out. I don't need it to be perfect because this is never going to be seen in close-up. I have an idea of what I'm going to use this for. It's for a project way in the future, so it is just a prop that will be seen in the background, so I don't have to go to town. Anyway, the main reason for this video is because I wanted to paint this gun, not in black, but even though on the film it does look like it's black, in quite a few of the close-ups it looks gunmetal grey, completely gunmetal grey, so I think that's what I'm going to go for. And that's what spawned this idea for this video. Now, I could sit there and use traditional gunmetal grey spray and just do it the very easy way. But I've decided to go along this route. This is graphite powder. This is how they used to do it in the old days, and I just thought, well, that'd be quite interesting to do. So let's use graphite powder to metallize the surface of this gun up. So I think that's what I'm going to do. Let me crack open the graphite and we'll start plonking it on there. Now, this is, well, it's going to be quite dark in there, so you probably won't see it, but it's a powder. So I'm going to just dip my brush in and putting it over there. Before we start, just want to put this glove on because it is going to be incredibly mucky. In fact, I might have put my sleeve up as well. So, let's just start. Get some on the brush. It's going to go everywhere, this stuff. And I'm going to liberally put it on. It is going to go everywhere. Just want to put it on in circular motions because it's that polishes the final look up. So if I bring it up, you may be able to see the dust, and all I'm doing is that. And the more I polish, the more it tends to go into this gunmetal grey colour. It's not going to be grey, and it's not going to be exactly black either, but I just want to get this all over the auction. So I am going to make a mess doing this. And let's just carry on. Yeah, I can just start seeing a sheen starting on this. So that just lifts it from being basically boring matte black to that gunmetal grey colour, which is very close to black, but like I said, it's got that metallic sheen. And it's all about the buffing. So, yep, if you let me carry on with this, we'll come back to it when it gets a bit more interesting. That's if it does get a bit more interesting. So now I've got a liberal coating of the graphite powder on there. I'm just going to take a lint-free cloth like this one here and just go over it and buff it. I will probably do a second coat. In fact, I will probably put a bit of lacquer on this and then put the powder over the top of it and polish it again. But this is just going to bring out the shine, so hopefully that's going to be enough. So here we are with the graphite powder on, and it's starting to look pretty metallic. Not so much on camera by the looks of it, but to the naked eye it's looking pretty good. But what I want to do now is I'm just going to put some matte lacquer on it. This will alter the finish, but all I'm going to do is just seal this in and then give it another blast of graphite powder. There we go. Let that one dry off a little bit. Grab the other one. So the clear lacquer is on there. It's been on there for just a few seconds, and I'm going to go over the whole thing again. And this should get locked in now because it's going straight into the lacquer. So I'm going to give it another liberal coating of this. Wouldn't be one of my videos without a police car going by. I wonder what's going on out there now. Again, this is still pretty tacky. I've only literally just sprayed it moments ago. So that's the opportune moment to start sticking this to it. Literally what I'm doing is I'm sticking the graphite powder to the lacquer, which is in turn stuck to the gun. So by rights, it should all stick to the gun nicely. And hopefully it will also seal it a bit if I work it directly into the lacquer. I mean, if I was doing this not on camera, I'd probably do a slightly better job, but it's only for demonstrational purposes, just so that you get the general idea of what the hell I'm doing. I mean, obviously, if you're going to do this to a gun or a toy of some sort, spaceship, you can take a lot more time and effort over it than I'm doing here. So I'm probably going a lot quicker than I normally would. Tap the excess off. Boop, 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 boop. Let's go back to the other one and get the old cloth out. and start buffing again. And then what I'll let it do is just dry and cure and see how that's coming up. Right now, that's looking all right to me. You know, this is a cheap toy and it does have a few stress lines in the plastic, which I'm never going to be able to get away with. But as I said, this is not for close inspection. This is something that will sit on a shelf, probably in the background somewhere. So I'm not overly bothered. Yeah, look at that. Looking a bit more gun-like. And then later on, I'm sure we'll discuss the legality of this, but for now, I'm not overly bothered. Because it's never going to go out into public. But we'll cover that topic later on. Just brush off any excess that's still there. Yeah. How's that looking? Yeah, isn't that nice? There we go, that's enough polishing there, I think. But just to give you a bit of contrast, there's a bit of a sheen there to it, and it's no longer black, but it's not exactly grey either. So it's a sort of metallic. And it looks good in the hand. Pew, 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 pew. So, next thing to do is the weathering. Now, let's be honest here. If you've got a gun in active service, it's going to be absolutely pristine, rather like this. However, that doesn't look good on TV or film, so what they tend to do, the effects guys or the props masters, is that they give it a bit of weathering, and they put on far more filth than would normally be on something like this. And I'm not a big fan of it, but yeah, I'll probably do it too, just to give it a little point of interest, because this isn't a real gun, it is a prop, it's meant to be seen on camera, I suppose. So yeah, why not? And besides, this casting of this gun isn't particularly brilliant. It's got lots of little defects, and the weathering will serve to hide some of that. You know, for a quick one-day arse around, it's not bad. Right, let's try the old Humbrol weathering powder. This is, what is it? I think it's Dark Earth. So yeah, let's try this out. Just put a bit in there. Oh yeah, that's looking all right. Yeah, that reads quite well. Again, because this is going on dry, we can manipulate it quite a bit and then wipe it off. So actually, yeah, that's looking all right. Again, just take another brush and wipe it back. I mean, this is completely over the top. No gun would ever look like this. But as I said, this is just a demonstrational thing. Let's put it down in the recess here. Slowly blend it back. Let's do some under here. So at this stage, it's not fixed. So we can manipulate this around, do it overboard, and then blend it back as much as we want. So that's what I'm going to do. And bring it over, there's some more down there. Just put that in there. In all the places the dust would catch and sit. Just up in here would be an area where it would catch. blend it out. So this is well and truly overboard, but let me carry on and see how far I get. Just going in a few select areas with the black powder, just to add another little bit of contrast, and that should pretty much be about it, I reckon. Yeah, just a touch more here. Don't want to completely undo the brownie tones, but just want to knock them back very slightly. So. Completely over the top weathering, but it illustrates a point. So that's where we are with it. As I said before, you'd never get weathering like this really on a gun, unless this is in the middle of combat or just come back from combat. But you know, I'm no great gun expert, but I'm sure guns don't get this filthy. So all I need to do now is seal that, I think. Yeah, that'll do. A slightly mucky gun. And so that's pretty much the finished gun. I decided against putting silver highlights on this because I just didn't think it would be that realistic. Not that this weathering is realistic in the slightest. I've just gone overboard, as I said previously, just showing the technique about using various powders. If you were to do something along these lines yourself, you can spend a lot more time and care over it. I literally just slapped the stuff around just to show the points that I was trying to make. So, yeah, I mean, the gun looks reasonable, it's got its metallic finish, it looks a bit grimy. But if this thing ever gets used, it'll only ever be in the background, so you'd only sort of see it like that with virtually no detail on show. Speaking of on show, the legality of this, I did touch on that about halfway through the video. Is it legal to convert a gun like this? Well, it all depends on where you live. For the most part, legally, it's frowned upon, and I'm aware of that, but this gun will never, ever go out into public. It's going to either stay inside my house in a box in a cupboard somewhere. My son will probably play with it in the garden for a few minutes and then discard it, and then if it ever does get used, it'll be in the background for a shot that I'm thinking of much later for a different project. This gun did not come with an orange tip, which most toys and replicas have to have by law. This one didn't have it, so you know, I could have put one on there, but by the same token, I've got a thing about the orange tips. Any deranged soul could take a real gun, put an orange tip on it, and then go and cause absolute carnage and mayhem out in public. So it's all swings and roundabouts, really, but if you're going to do your own gun, be careful, don't be stupid with it, keep it to yourself. Don't go talking about it either, because even something like this, if it got into the wrong hands, who knows what could happen. Anyway, let's get on with it. So, what do I think? Yeah, it's fine, it'll do. So anyway, hopefully that's given you a few ideas for... It doesn't have to be used on guns, by the way. You can use these same processes on anything. But hopefully it's given you a few ideas. All that's left for me to do now is to thank you very much for joining me. It's always a pleasure. I hope you've enjoyed what you've seen, and I'll see you next time.